Deutschland und hinter uns kommt Deutschland.
I still remember listening to Hitler's speeches over that radio. It was, you know, it was shocking to hear the way he was speaking right there and then, and nobody imagined the consequences which will follow from those speeches.
In 1994, after filming Schindler's List, Steven Spielberg established Survivors of the Shoah Visual History Foundation to gather the testimonies of Holocaust survivors and other witnesses before it was too late. Preservation is at the cornerstone of why we exist. We can talk about education, but if we don't preserve the testimonies, we can't do anything with them. When you think about an archive like this, you have to think about an entity that's going to exist in 500 years.
Suddenly you see somebody running to you, bald, with a long striped gown. We didn't recognize one. We kissed, and that's the last time I saw one. It's a tough sight and a tougher memory.
There is a method for that storage that allows us to preserve them so that the life stories that are captured on video will never be lost. So generations never forget what so few live to tell.
Our group is responsible for the technology to collect, catalog, preserve, and access all of the testimonies collected by the Institute for Tolerance Education. We collected 52,000 interviews in 32 languages from 56 countries around the world, Holocaust testimonies, and today we're also collecting from other histories, such as the Rwandan genocide. When the Shoah Foundation changed from being a standalone nonprofit to becoming an institute at USC, there was a number of shifts we had to make. What we had to do was move from our current architecture, which was not sun-based, to a sun-based architecture, which USC was mostly based. And so what Sun did was provide us with servers and systems to be able to distribute our 135 terabyte version of our Access low-res copies out to universities around the world. We have 235,000 tapes that we need to turn into files. Those 235,000 tapes we're putting in a robotic system which cranks through them and creates the files automatically and puts them onto a storage tech system. So they're literally taking the analog tapes and creating files as fast as they can and writing it to the Sun SAMFS QFS file system, which is on the front end of these large online archives from storage tech. And we check all the way step by step to make sure that the quality of the signal that we take off the tape is identical by the time it arrives on the storage tech systems from using the SAMFS QFS file system.
What we see here are our main data stores and our main servers. The data stores are the 6540s and the servers are the X4600s. Every time a videotape gets digitized, it finds its way onto our data stores. And from here, over SAMFS, it's going to get copied onto our two silos, the SL8500s. What you see behind me are our two SL8500 silos. We hold about 8,500 tapes that have the entire testimony of the VHI in it. It has an addressing capacity of over 8.5 petabytes. What we have here are the X4500s, also known as thumpers. These thumpers hold each and every one of the 52,000 testimonies we have. The thumpers are used to transfer the data across the internet to the different museums and universities around the world.
The Institute's archive sits at an important juncture between a unique and significant content regarding the Holocaust and really about the 20th century, as well as the field of visual literacy and media studies. there's a generational change in how students interact with text versus media in this very visually oriented culture that students are really growing up in now. So we're very interested in being a part of that conversation about visual literacy and media studies.
The first time I heard about Shoah Foundation was through a history course. And the whole point was we were talking about written history opposed to visual history. With text, you can read something and it will say words and you take everything in. But when you watch a video, when you see someone, you really get a sense of their emotion. You feel what they're feeling. And even if they're not speaking, you get a sense of what was happening to them based on facial expression or hand motion. It's a whole nother way of learning history. It's not reading something and interpreting it the way you want to. It's actually watching someone and seeing how they're interpreting it and how it affected them. So it puts a whole different spin on learning history, and a great spin.
The fact that the preservation is so state-of-the-art allows us to optimize what we're doing educationally and allows us to optimize what we're doing from an access perspective.